Faith matters. An interactive program brought to you by MTA International.
Assalamu alaikum and welcome to Faith Matters, a program where you, our viewers, set the agenda by the questions you ask. And right from the outset, Jazakumullah and thank you for the questions you've been sending in for today's program. But before we go to those and for me to introduce the panel, just a reminder again of the email. It's faithmatters@mta.tv. That's faithmatters@mta.tv. And the fax number, for those of you wishing to use the fax, it's 44 for the UK, 208-687-8037. And with that, it's my absolute pleasure and delight to welcome a very esteemed panel to Faith Matters this evening. Assalamu alaikum, gentlemen. Welcome to Faith Matters. To my immediate right is Dr. Zaid Khan Sahib, a familiar face on Faith Matters. As viewers will know, he's the president of the Qaza Board here in the United Kingdom. Assalamu alaikum. To his right is a first for Faith Matters. It's my pleasure to welcome Salim Ahmed Sahib from Leicester. He's a judge of employment law and a previous chairman of the Amdia Muslim Lawyers Association. Assalamu alaikum and welcome to Faith Matters, Salim Saab.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah.
And to his right, again, a familiar face and a welcome face, and a face we always are very fond of to welcome to Faith Matters, Azhar Hanif Sahib, our missionary from the United States, and of course Azhar Sahib is also the Naib Amir of the United States Jamaat. Welcome, Azhar Sahib, to Faith Matters.
Assalamu alaikum.
We're going to have a sort of world tour of questions as well on the subjects we've been raised, but we're sort of going to be quite focused in today's program on issues about blasphemy and the whole issue which surrounds around apostasy and such like within Islam. And we're going to start with the first question, which comes from Osama Khan Sahib from Bavaria in Germany. Jazakumullah Osama Sahib for your question. He thanks the Faith Matters panel for their questions and lively answers, and poses one himself, and it's this: it is my firm belief that Islam is a religion of love and tolerance. Despite of this fact, I've heard many times, especially from Arab Muslims, that if any Muslim converts to any other religion and leaves Islam, he or she is liable for the death penalty. But when I read the verse, and he quotes the verse number 138 in the Holy Quran, chapter 4, those, quote, those who believe, then disbelieve, then again believe, then disbelieve, and then increase in disbelief, Allah will never forgive them, nor will He guide them to the way. I understand that according to this verse, their argument goes totally against the Holy Quran. Please could you explain this verse for me and what is really meant? Dr. Saab, if I could start with you on that one.
I think Osama is absolutely correct in saying that Islam is a religion of peace, a religion of tolerance, a religion of freedom. So keeping that overall picture in mind, one has to look at issues that arise within the sphere and try to look for reasoned answers through that. And when we know that Islam is a religion of peace, it maintains, promotes peace, and also a religion of freedom, then we know that the Muslim is given all rights of human rights that are due to him. Mm-hmm. And the right to practice one's faith is also given to him. So we of course know that Allah mentions in the Holy Quran, La ikraha fid din, that there is no compulsion in religion. And being that Islam is a religion of common sense, then it also it stems from that, that it means that there is no compulsion for someone to convert into Islam, or for someone also to leave Islam. And we see from this particular verse too, that the situation Allah has given us in this respect is quite clear.
Of course.
It is for someone who believes, then disbelieves, then believes again, and then disbelieves, so that there are situations when we have seen in history that this has taken place during the time of the Holy Prophet of Islam, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The door of repentance, however, has not been closed just for the mere fact that you have disbelieved. And that door of repentance from these verses is kept open. It is only when you go on increasing in your disbelief that the door of repentance is then shut by Allah because of your increase in disbelief. But as far as converting and then reconverting is concerned, Allah permits this. And interestingly, there is no punishment that is mentioned in this particular verse. The Holy Quran is full of verses in which this subject is mentioned and discussed at length. And also the life of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we see instances where this occurred and this was allowed to occur without any bar being put in position that someone who had become a Muslim could not then leave Islam if he so wished. Mm-hmm. So therefore, keeping all of this in mind, we are absolutely sure that because freedom of religion, freedom to practice a faith has been given to mankind, and Islam allows that. So from these we can safely conclude, and going on to many other verses of the Holy Quran, we can safely conclude that that apostasy, meaning that to recant your faith, has been allowed in Islam, and therefore no punishment in that respect has been left for man to mete out. It is a crime, in fact, against the Creator. It is a crime against Allah. It is not a crime against another human being. And for that, retribution or judgment is also reserved against whom the crime is committed, against Allah. So the crime that is being committed, Allah will be the one who will judge and then punish as he wishes in that respect.
Salim Saab, if I could come to you, and that's not because the word judge has just been used, but it's a convenient introduction to your good self. But nevertheless, in this instance, we do find across the Muslim world and across the world generally that there are people who stand both as judge and jury and actually saying this person has moved away from Islam, has moved away from the faith. Dr. Saab's been quite clear in what the Holy Quran states. Why do these people come up with this notion, and where do they come up with these notions from?
Well, it's a very difficult issue for them to explain, because the Holy Quran is completely against their position. The starting point, I think, always has to be the Holy Quran, and the Holy Quran is quite explicit on this. In Surah Al-Baqarah, verse 218, we read, "And whoso from among you turns back from his faith and dies while he is a disbeliever, it is they whose work shall be in vain in this world and the next. These are the inmates of the fire, and therein shall they abide." So there's no reference there to any punishment by any authority or by any state. And indeed there are many verses, something like 20 times the reference to apostasy is mentioned in the Holy Quran, but on no occasion is there any prescribed human punishment, as Dr. Zayed Saheb has explained. All of the punishments are from Allah Ta'ala himself. And we find numerous references. Surah Al-Maidah, for example, O ye who believe, whoso among you turns his back from his religion, then let it be known in his stead, Allah will soon bring a people whom he will love. So the Holy Quran is absolutely explicit and clear. There are very few subjects that are dealt with this length on so many occasions that on no occasion is reference to punishment by worldly authorities permitted. In fact, we can go further, because even the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not permitted to punish, and the extent of the jurisdiction of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is to pass on the message and obey Allah and obey the messenger and be on your guard. But if you turn away, then know that on our messenger lies only the clear conveyance of the message. Chapter 5, verse 93. And there are many other verses to this effect. I think the problem arises from the interpretation, the wrong interpretation of some hadith. But the Holy Quran, which has to be our starting point, is absolutely explicit and very clear. There is no worldly punishment that any authority can mete out for apostasy. It is a punishment from Allah Ta'ala only.
I think that's quite clear. Jazakumullah, gentlemen, and Osama, I trust your question has been answered. You know what to do. faithmatters@mta.tv if you've got any thoughts or observations on the answer you've heard. We're going to sort of move from Germany to Pakistan next. The question is from Umar Mali Sahib. He extends a very warm assalamu alaikum to the panel. He writes that after introducing himself, he refers to the sad incidents in which the governor of Pakistan, the governor of Punjab in Pakistan, was assassinated by his own bodyguard. He's of course referring to the sad incidents of Salman Taseer, who was brutally murdered. Indeed, we've seen subsequent attacks in Pakistan. Most recently, Federal Minister Shahbaz Bhatti, who was the only Christian in the government of Pakistan, was also brutally assassinated. And he says that he's been having discussions with another person who was somehow trying to justify his murder, and he was suggesting that there were hadiths justifying these particular issues. And in this context, before I sort of come to the question as well, I also wish to just note that we've received quite a detailed sort of thoughts and observations from Khalid Saifullah Khan Sahib, the Naib Amir of Jamaat Ahmadiyya Australia. Jazakallah, Khalid Sahib, for your very detailed article on blasphemy. And there are various references made, in particular to the famous Pakistani blasphemy law 295C, which is sometimes used as is at all times used as a justification against different communities, including the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, on acts perpetrated against the community. Now, he refers to some hadith that he's quoting to, that he's saying that this particular gentleman quoted to him in justifying these attacks. Azhar Sahib, I mean, this whole basis, I mean, of course, we condemn unequivocally the taking of any innocent life, and this was a really, yet again, destabilizing crime for the state of Pakistan. Here was a gentleman, just in the context, Salman Taseer Sahib, who raised his voice against these draconian laws of blasphemy. Do they have a basis? I mean, what is the basis of blasphemy laws? Let's start off there.
Well, we've heard, by Allah's grace, from a man who's well-versed in the Sharia, the law of Islam, Dr. Zaid Khan Saab. And we've heard from a man also, Salim Saab, who's versed in the penal code, you know, the laws of the land. Both have already told us that when the penalty is one committed, the crime committed against man, fellow man in society, then society has the right to ensure that justice and harmony amongst the people prevail. But when the crime as such is not between man and man, it's between man and God, then there's no earthly power that's been given the right in any scripture to take this matter into their hands and to judge this case, other than to say, we believe this person has a change of faith, out of our fold, no longer part of our group, our administration, whatever. That's the best they can do. But they have no right to then punish that person for having left them or joined another group.
Of course.
This is the essence here, which has been so striking to the Western world when they look at the Islamic communities allowing this. And as you said in the case in Pakistan, they're praising this. They're giving this man a status as if he is the hero of the nation for having taken this stance and taken this position and committed this crime against God and humanity. And
indeed, I say they couldn't find anyone to prosecute him. That was the ridiculous nature of the situation.
The whole situation falls to the wayside when you think these are the same individuals, Muslims across the board, who say the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is uswa hasana. He is the excellent example of all behavior. Ask these same Muslims, in the time of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was he or was he not himself abused and insulted and blasphemed as a prophet? The language, the actions against him during the years he lived in Mecca, so heinous crimes were committed against him. There was one lady who would abuse him constantly and throw rubbish on him as he's passing through the street and call him names. The poor lady in Pakistan, she's still in jail because she has, you know, committed this crime against the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And other cases, and you know, the Christians and other non-Muslims have committed the crime of so-called abusing Allah, abusing the Quran, or doing these things. It is ludicrous when you consider in the context of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I asked them the question: did our messenger not know the Quran? Was the Quran not revealed to him in a way that he understood how to implement and execute the orders, if the order is to kill someone who leaves the faith? And leaving the faith is not one time in the verse. This, the Quran says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا ثُمَّ قَفَرُوا, that this, those who believe and then disbelieve, ثُمَّ آمَنُوا, they come back in. How did he allow them to come back in? how would they come back into the fold if once they disbelieve, the order should have been death? I've never understood that. And the Arabs who know Arabic very well, he says the Arabs are telling him this is, you know, this is against Islam. An Arab is not reading Quran. I'm not Arab. I'm reading Quran here. This surah An-Nisa, it's very clear. Allah is saying, Inna ladina amanu. Arab means what? Mm-hmm. Those who believe. Thumma kafuru. Then they disbelieve. The issue here is apostasy. That person should be what? An apostate. According to what we're being told here, that person should be killed, put to death. But if you put him to death, then how does the next verse make any sense? Thumma amanu, and then they believe again. Thumma kafuru, and after that, again, they revert to disbelief. So you have a vacillation here of faith and you know, lack of faith. It makes no sense. The Prophet must have read this. He must have known. He has the best Arabic, and yet he never implemented this idea of someone who blasphemes against Islam, or someone who goes in and out of the fold of Islam, should be put to death.
Jazakumullah. Dr. Zaid, if I come to you, and in doing so, I just want to read out here, again, thanks and my earnest thanks to Khalid Sahib, Naib Amir of Jamaat Ahmadi Australia, for his article. And just taking from that, quoting section 295C, and I'm quoting here, it says, use of derogatory remarks in respect of the Holy Prophet, whoever by words either spoken or written, or by visible representation, or by imputation, innuendo, or insinuation, directly or indirectly, defiles the sacred name of the Holy Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, shall be, after saying all of that, punished with death, imprisonment for life, and shall be also liable to fine. Few things in the way that law's been drafted, and I'll come to Salim Saab in a moment. It seems the lesser, the fining is at the end, but they've already killed the person and imprisoned them. But, you know, this is a serious, obviously, issue. That's the basis of it. But as we've heard from Azhar Sahib already, again, following the logic in the way the verse has been revealed as well, that if someone is disbelieving and then goes back to belief, if when they disbelieve, they've been killed, there's the coming back to belief no longer exists because they're no longer in the world. Here's the basis of what's been used. You have people, sadly to say, it's not just an illiterate people who are saying this. These are quite educated people, indeed, so-called ulama of Islam, who are actually propagating this law.
That is the shame of it all, that, as you say, that people who call themselves well-versed in Islam are not able to grasp the simplest of these arguments that we put forward. Are they not familiar, as Azhar Sahib has said, with the life of the Holy Prophet of Islam, sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Have they not seen what was meted out to him in Makkah, as we have seen? And the Holy Quran is full of references of those people who mocked prophets. You see, mocking and disparaging prophets is said to be as old as prophecy itself. So this has been a pattern of all the prophets that have been sent by God Almighty. The Holy Prophet was no exception. He was na'uzubillah called a madman. He was na'uzubillah called a sorcerer. Then we have seen that the chief of the hypocrites called him the meanest of men of Medina, called himself the most superior of men. Was the Prophet, as we have said, not aware of these commandments of the Holy Quran? Why was he not killed? Not only was he not killed, but what was the Prophet's treatment of this man, for instance? Let's take Abdullah bin Ubay ibn Salul. He was the chief of the hypocrites. This is what he said about the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was well recorded. It is mentioned in the Holy Quran as well. So the Prophet was aware that this is what he has said about me, this is blasphemy. No, what happened was when he died, the Prophet went and stood by his body. And Umar ibn Khattab, radiallahu anhu, he stood behind him and said, O Prophet of Allah, are you going to pray for this enemy of Allah? The Prophet just turned and smiled at him. He said, I have been given the choice and I have chosen. I have chosen that I will pray for him. Allah has said that he will not forgive this man even if I pray for him for 70 times, and I am going to pray for more. And that was the example that was laid before us. So this is how he dealt with someone who was a blasphemer. Not only did he not put him to death, that totally opposite scenario has been brought to us. This is Islam, you know? This is what the picture of Islam is as we portray to the world over. This is the pure Islam. Not only that, but we know another interesting thing, if I just may, is that the Jews of Medina, they had very sharp tongues and a very sick sense of humor. And in their poetry, they used to instigate people, the people of Medina, against the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And Maxine Rodinson has aptly described them, these propagandists, as the journalists of the time. So, you know, even in that time, at the time of the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, there were exactly what we have seen in our lifetime of the writers and the cartoonists. They were present in the time of the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, but history records no instance of any punishment that was given out to these people for the type of blasphemy that they carried out. And it is a grave shame that such a simple basic point cannot be understood by these mullahs around the world in that respect.
And a final point on this, Jazakallah, Dr. Saab, Salim Saab, if I could come to you as a jurist, as someone who knows the law, here's a framing of a law. We've heard quite clearly that the basis, if it's the Holy Quran, well, their framing of the law is erroneous because the Holy Quran is explicit in saying quite the opposite. Yet the basis of this is used as an interpretation, and sometimes the justification used is hadith, the sayings of the Holy Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he then said it. Yet the Holy Quran, i.e. the word of God, as Muslims hold it, says something quite different.
Well, the hadith, no matter which particular book of hadith we're talking about, cannot take precedence over the Holy Quran. Where the Holy Quran gives a clear and decisive verdict, then that is the verdict that must be obeyed. And the Holy Quran could not be clearer. In Surah Al-Azab, Allah the Almighty says, verily, those who malign Allah and His Messenger, and this is what we're talking about here, maligning Allah and His Messenger, Allah has cursed them in this world and in the hereafter, and has prepared for them an abasing punishment. No reference to any punishment by any secular state. Therefore, no secular state has the power to say, look, we are going to punish you for defaming the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or for maligning him, or for saying anything which hurts our sensitivities. No interpretation into the statute books of a Muslim state, if it is to be consistent with Islamic teachings, can ignore this particular verse. So there may be other reasons, there may be political reasons why this finds itself into the statute books, but whatever the reason, it is certainly not based on the teachings of Islam.
That's very clear, gentlemen. Thank you for that. And Umar Saab, Jazakumullah, thank you for your question. But I think the clearest point, which certainly comes from all the panelists and indeed is the basis and understanding and indeed the propagation of Islam that's presented by the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, is that the Holy Quran, the word of Allah, takes precedence over all other interpretations. Indeed, if there is a hadith which is contradictory to the word of God, then it is, of course, the word of God that should prevail. We're going to move to the USA for our next question, and that comes from Bilal Ahmed Sahib. And he, again, refers to, I'm sure, just to put it into the context of this question for our viewers, he refers to the three members of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community who were brutally murdered in Indonesia not so long ago in the name of religion. I believe the events took place on the 6th of February. Punishment for apostasy was also used to justify these atrocities. Bilal Saab asks, can you please shed light on what the punishment of apostasy is in Islam? Just for the benefit of our viewers, tragically on the 6th of February of this year, 2011, three Ahmadi Muslims who were just at their own center were attacked brutally by a mob who were claiming to be defending the honor of the Holy Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And brutally, in the cold light of day, in the eyes of cameras, indeed, under the guise of the police and authorities, brutally killed three Ahmadis through literally beating them to death. It was a horrific attack. It was one of those stomach-churning moments, which was also captured on cameras and has caused outrage across all communities, not just within the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. But Azhar Sahab, if I could start with you, first of all, this whole essence of punishment, of apostasy in Islam, where does that actually originate from? I mean, it's an erroneous interpretation. Our other answers have already dealt in part with this, but if we could take that specific issue.
You know, it doesn't have any root. It doesn't have any justification in the Holy Quran. I think we've more or less established that fact.
Absolutely.
It's also not to be found in the practice, the Sunnah of the Holy Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who illustrates and who gives us the model of behavior for following the injunctions of the Holy Quran. So if these two main sources, and as Muslims we only have two main sources, which the Holy Prophet said in his last speech to us as Muslim in the Muslim world, I leave you with two things. If you hold fast to them, you will be rightly guided. Basically, this is his message to us. One is Quran, and the second is my Sunnah.
Yes.
But you can see what happened, and you say, where does this come from? It's in this problem, letting go of this very strong rope that's from heaven, the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the rope of the messenger. And instead, now reinterpreting the scripture to fall in line with one's perhaps political views.
Mm-hmm.
Or cultural stance that we have the right to start determining human affairs. I mean, what you've just described in posing this question, I think no one's spirit would not be recoiled by this. You know, I mean, everyone just is just so appalled and disgusted when you looked at those scenes. If you had a chance to see them,
indeed,
this was inhumanity.
Yeah.
Leave spirituality, morality at the issue. This very fact of the beastly nature of the attack that took place there reminds you throughout human history of all these scenes here in, you know, the Christian world, which they try to cover those pages up now because it is so ghastly scenes. The torturous moments that people did in the name of Jesus Christ, a prophet of peace, as we recognize him. Or in other religions, you know, these are the things you want to hide and shudder from the world. And these Muslims are pushing in front of the world, this represents Islam. Which Islam? The Islam of the Quran? No. The Islam of the Holy Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who was Rahmatul Lil Alameen, who was most merciful of all the people on this planet. And when someone came in front of him of a different faith, he would sit them down and he would dialogue with them. Then he would say, فَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيُؤْمِنْ فَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيَكْفُرْ. If you want, you can believe what I have to say. If you want, you can disbelieve. End of the matter. There's no issue whether even if you are Muslim today, you can leave the faith tomorrow and join someone else. This is a prerogative, which a right given to you by God, which he fought for in all of his wars to determine the course of human nature, human events in the future. Everyone has the right. Everyone has the right. If not so, can you imagine if we as Muslims living in a non-Muslim majority country, would we want that government and that religious group to treat us the same way now? For this is justice here. Do to the others what you would want them to do to you.
Of course.
And so should they now start killing us if we are Muslims joining their faith and leaving their faith? Would that be the principle that will create peace in this world? And have we not already experienced this scenario in many non-Muslim nations? So there's really no premise, there's no precedent, there's no principle that we can look at that would allow someone to say apostasy should be punished with death, imprisonment, or something of a nature of what we saw in the case of these three innocent Ahmadis in Indonesia and elsewhere in the Muslim world, unfortunately.
Jazakumullah, Azhar Sahab. I'm going to move forward with Bilal Sahab's second question, and Salim Sahab, if perhaps I can come to you on this. He asks, I guess he's sort of following on from what we saw, where they were so-called Muslims who were taking law into their own hands, who were using some kind of justification of state law, constitutional law, to actually say we're going to justify and protect the Holy Prophet by our actions, astaghfirullah, in terms of their actions. But does Islam, and this is a question being posed, allow the public to take matters into their own hands to implement punishments of any kind, or is it the responsibility of the government to implement regulations or laws, I'm sure?
Well, the short answer is that it is for the government to enforce the criminal law. Mm-hmm. And where there is a violation of that particular law, then it is only the state which has the right to enforce punishment. There may be certain instances where those involved, the families of those involved, may forgive or may seek recompense. But primarily, the right of punishment is only the prerogative of the state. Anything else would be tantamount to civil disorder, because the first question that would arise is, what is the punishment to be imposed? Now, punishment can only be imposed by an objective judge or state or body which is not involved in the incident itself. And Islam only permits recompense to the extent of the injury. So it is impossible for anyone who is involved directly to be objective about the crime that is committed against them. And therefore, it is always a case that punishment of certain crimes are the sole prerogative of the state and not the individual. Otherwise, as I say, you have anarchy, you have the right for everyone to say...
You've got to sustain the rule of law.
Absolutely. And Islam is very clear, and always has been very clear, that certain offences against society are punishable by the state only.
But then some would argue, perhaps, in Pakistan that laws like 295C, under that people are allowed to register cases when they feel that they're... sensitivities have been hurt by someone else, and then they use, if you like, the context of the rule of law to actually sort of put forward a case to a judge, who then judge rules on the basis of that law.
Well, the question of sensitivities is a very difficult one, and it is filled with all kinds of difficulties for those involved and the enforcers of a particular law. It is very easy, as was recognized in the Munir inquiry, for...
That was after the 1953,
after the 1953 riots
against the Ahmadiyya Muslim
community. And the Munir inquiry was instigated as a result of those to find out what had happened. And it was commented that one of the easiest ways in which we can evoke feelings of indignation is to say that our sensitivities have been somehow... offended by reference to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I mean, leaving aside the fact that the vast majority of these people who are so offended do not follow the teachings of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They do not follow his example in the main, but nevertheless they are very offended when there is a reference to him. Of course, a true Muslim is always offended when there is a disparaging reference to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that should not in any way be taken lightly. But the question arises as to who is entitled to punish, and we've seen that there is no punishment that the state can have, let alone any individual. So no individual can say, well, look, I'm entitled to recompense and I'm going to do this to you because my sensitivities have been hurt, because not even the state has that power. That is a matter for Allah Ta'ala and Allah Ta'ala alone. It is not the province of any individual or state to start getting into sensitivities. It is a very slippery issue, and unfortunately Pakistan is caught in the grip of the problems that come when you institute legislation as they have.
Indeed. Ironic, is it not, Dr. Salman, that the very perceived or self-perceived guardians of the protection of the noble Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam are actually acting in total contradiction to the teachings of Allah Ta'ala and his teachings and example. But just in that context, one final sort of question Bilal Saab had was the issue of Islamic teachings on human rights in relation particularly to minorities. And he then also asked, and those you consider not to be on the right path. I would sort of caveat that question by it makes a presumption, and for all our viewers, not at all are we suggesting that anyone who isn't Muslim or everyone who is Muslim is always on the straight path, not at all. But I think there's two sort of elements to this. What is the Islamic sort of injunctions and teachings on human rights in relation to how non-Muslims should be dealt with under a Islamic state? And also,
I suppose it's a very broad question, but those who aren't on the right path, reformation is ultimately the answer that Islam gives for everyone.
Well, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the UN Charter, I mean, that only came into being in 1948. And it is interesting how all the articles of that charter have their foundations in the Holy Quran and in the life of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Islam is that religion who actually introduced a full charter of human rights for mankind to follow, so that social justice and social peace would always be implemented and be brought into society. It is also interesting that just dwelling on the subject of human rights as far as religious freedom is concerned, and we have no better example than the life of the Holy Prophet of Islam sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we see clearly in Medina, for instance, when the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there are instances where we can see that the pact that he made, for instance, in Medina, the Charter of Tolerance, the second condition of that pact was that people would have religious freedom despite Muslims being in the majority. So this is guaranteeing the followers of other faiths who were in minority that they would have absolute freedom to practice their faith as they wished. Then he, as we know, permitted the Christians of Najran who came to him to actually use his mosque to pray in that mosque. Now actually they faced eastwards to pray when they were in that mosque, and the companions of the Prophet ﷺ felt that this should not have been allowed, you know, and the Prophet just smiled and he said, no, that is fine, they are permitted to do that. So that is again giving tolerance and human rights in as far as religious expression is concerned. And then the letter of immunity that the Holy Prophet ﷺ gave to these people of Najran, that is interesting to read the letter of immunity that was given to them. He undertook the responsibility of protection of the boundaries of the Christians. It was an obligation of Muslims to protect their churches, their inns, and their places of worship, no matter where they were located, whether they were nearby in cities or whether they were in woods. It was for the Muslims to ensure their protection in that respect. So in all of that, we can see that this was the religious tolerance and this was the freedom that was given to followers of other faiths who were in the minority so that they could practice their faith as they wished.
Jazakumullah, gentlemen. How ironic, just to sort of conclude on Bilal Saab's questions, that noble example of the Holy Prophet, as we've, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that we've just heard, is far from the practice we see in reality, where mosques and indeed churches are being burnt down and pulled down in the name of Islam. And just on that, gentlemen, we're just going to break now for our book review of the week. And this week we're going to be reviewing the book Murder in the Name of Allah, which was written by Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmad Sahib, Allah be pleased with him, who was the fourth Khalif of the Ahmadiyya Muslim Jamaat. And this book was actually an English translation of the book he wrote, which was Mazhab Ke Naam Par Khoon. And the book's a reminder that the purpose of any religion, including Islam, is the spread of peace, tolerance, and understanding. And it puts forward the case and argues the case that the meaning of Islam, submission to the will of God, has been steadily corrupted by minority elements in the Muslim community. Instead of spreading peace, the religion has been abused by fanatics and made an excuse for violence, the spread of terror, both inside and outside the faith. And indeed, the examples we've just been discussing in Pakistan and Indonesia are practical testament to that. So that's the book review for this week, and we'll be just breaking for that, and we'll join you again shortly.
Assalamu alaikum. Murder in the Name of Allah by Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmed, Khalifatul Masih IV. Hardly a day passes on which an Islamic event does not make headlines. Murder in the Name of Allah is a general review with special emphasis on the subject of freedom of expression in Islam. This book is a reminder that the purpose of any religion is the spread of peace, tolerance, and understanding. It urges that meaning of Islam, submission to the will of God, has been steadily corrupted by minority elements in the community. Instead of spreading peace, the religion has been abused by fanatics and made an excuse for violence and the spread of terror, both inside and outside the faith. In confirming the true spirit of Islam, it makes the point to followers of all religions that the future of mankind depends on the intrinsic values of love, tolerance, and freedom of conscience and belief. An outstanding book on the subject of true teachings of Islam and its corrupted implementation in our world today. A quotation from the book. As far as Islam is concerned, it categorically rejects and condemns every form of terrorism. It does not provide any cover or justification for any act of violence, be it committed by an individual, a group, or a government. I most strongly condemn all acts and forms of terrorism because it is my deeply rooted belief that not only Islam, but also no true religion, whatever its name, can sanction violence and bloodshed of innocent men, women, and children in the name of God. Murder in the Name of Allah by Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmed, the former head of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community.
Assalamu alaikum and welcome back to Faith Matters after the book review. Gentlemen, just before we broke for the review, we were talking about instances that have happened both in Pakistan and Indonesia. And I think it'd be fair to say also, I think the Indonesian government now has actually arrested people who committed those crimes. And we hope, and we have a judge present with us today, that the rule of law does prevail. And we do see justice prevail for the innocent victims and indeed their families in Indonesia. Indonesia has a strong vision for religious tolerance. One hopes that will be their vision for the future as well. And our best wishes and support go to them for that. We're going to move to our next question, which is Asim Yusuf from Pakistan, who poses a question. Assalamu alaikum, first of all, to the panel. And he asked that if any Muslim was punished under Torah law, stoning to death was something prescribed by the Torah prior to Surah Nur of the Holy Quran being revealed. And he asks if there was any instance of that. And his second link question is, if amputation of the hand was carried out during, or is there any example of amputations of hands being carried out during Rasulullah Pak Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's time? And to quote a tradition or a book of tradition which supports that. So the first thing, this was a practice prior to the revealing of that particular surah, that there was the stoning of death, which was practiced under Judaic law, as was presented. Salim Saab, if I could start with you on that one. Is there any instances, or indeed, first of all, I think it would be useful for our viewers to actually say what Surah Nur actually states and the context in which that was done.
Yes, certainly. The relevant verse in the Holy Quran is in Surah Al-Nur, verse 3, and that says that the adulteress and the adulterer flog each one of them with 100 stripes. Now, pausing there, most translations of the Holy Quran add the words "or the fornicator" in brackets because it is an issue which may arise, but the word for adultery and fornication in Arabic is the same, so there's no distinction. Flog each one of them with 100 stripes, and let not pity for the twain take hold of you in executing the judgment of Allah, if you believe in Allah on the last day, and let a party of the believers witness their punishment. There is no reference in this verse to stoning. Stoning was the punishment under the Mosaic law, and it was the practice of the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to apply the Mosaic law until there was any variation revealed to him. When this verse in Surah Al-Nur was revealed, then the punishment changed from stoning to flogging. And therefore, there was a dramatic change in the law. But until that point, there are instances of where the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam applied, but I should say very reluctantly applied, the Mosaic law. Usually when the culprits or those involved were the Jews for whom the Torah was the applicable provision. But even there, the view of the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was that the punishment should be overlooked wherever possible. And there's a very famous hadith where someone approached the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said he had committed adultery, and the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam walked away. And this gentleman then came round from another direction and approached the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam again and said, "I've committed adultery," and the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed him again and effectively sidestepped him. And it was only on the fourth occasion, when he'd confessed, that reluctantly the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the law must be applied. So it was always the case that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was very, very reluctant to impose this punishment. But the previous punishment, for which we are often condemned, is not the Islamic teaching. It was the precursor. Now, you may say, well, why is it that in some Muslim countries they still have stoning for adultery?
Well, everyone associates that.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. An erroneous
interpretation. It is erroneous, as is the interpretation that zina only applies to adultery or not to fornication. There is no distinction, so the two are to be treated entirely the same. But again, this is a misunderstanding or a misconception of the application of what is very clear verse in the Holy Quran, that it is flogging and not stoning. So it is not the Islamic punishment to have stoning, and any stoning would, I would suggest, be directly contrary to the teachings of Islam.
So any sort of situation which would have arose prior to the revelation, of course, that would have been under Mosaic law.
Absolutely, absolutely. And that was a practice of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He until there was a change, he would apply the old law.
I'm going to sort of mix this question from a question we've also got from Ronald in Austria. Thank you, Ronald, for your question, because there's a continuing theme here about apostasy, the basis of hadith vis-a-vis the Holy Quran. And again, he asks a similar question about there are several hadith sayings of the Holy Prophet Muhammad which orders sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who orders to kill apostates and to also stone men and women that commit adultery. And again, this is, Azhar Saab, one of the common allegations. Salim Saab had said, yet its basis is not in Quranic law. Indeed, Quranic law actually came and qualified and indeed relieved this punishment, mm-hmm. and actually prescribe a different punishment for such crimes. But nevertheless, if we could just bring it back to this, far too often we see instances across the Muslim world where both these crimes are perceived as deserving of death.
Yes, well, there's an expression which we sometimes say, that a dying man will also grab a brick, you know, going down, instead of grabbing something that can save his life. And in fact, this is what we see in most of these scenarios. There's nothing that gives them a precedent or a principle from the Quran. That's been clear, I think, throughout this program. There's nothing that shows them in the life of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that allows them even a concession to be taken, that maybe in this case or in this circumstance he applied the law, where, you know, generally he was very lenient, he was, you know, very inclined toward being merciful and compassionate. But here's a case where he definitely drew the line, and in every instance of this kind of case, he applied the law to its to the highest level of the law. But, you know, you take an example out of context, it becomes a principle. And I think this is what many Muslims have done. You take one example, it could have been prior to the revelation of Surah An-Nur, and try to make that the principle of the Holy Quran, and people will begin, you know, preaching and promoting this as if it's the law of the Holy Quran. Example comes to mind where a Muslim and a non-Muslim were arguing during the time of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the case came before him. If you read the hadith that's presented by some Muslims, at the end of this tradition, Hazrat Omar heard the decision of the Holy Prophet, which was, you should not have taken the position of hitting this man, or you know, kind of admonishing this man. You should have, you know, more or less allowed him to say what he was saying. What was he saying? He was saying that Moses, Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, is superior to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And of course the Muslim responded by saying what? I believe that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is Khatam al-Nabiyyin. He's the greatest of all time. He's the most beloved messenger. And the Jew then turned around and disagreed. No, no, I said Moses is the greatest. Well, he didn't end with verbs, he went into physical attack and hit the man.
So the Muslim hit the Jewish.
This Jewish man for insulting, the blaspheming his prophet. Mm-hmm. And when the matter came before the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he ruled in favor of the Jew.
On what basis?
On the basis that you should not say something that more or less is going to offend his sensibilities. This is a civil order. Now, he lived amongst Arabs and who were not Muslim, Jewish, or Christian. They had their own traditional religions. He had Jews in the society, he had Christians, and he had Muslims. He had to maintain peace and order. So in this case, he was telling him the principle of order and civility far outweighs the offense you may have felt through your own personal belief system. That's a matter between, again, man and God. Don't bring it into civil affairs, which leads to this kind of disruption, this order, and bloodshed. But the striking thing is, in one tradition you'll find being quoted, that at the end of this tradition, Hazrat Umar, who heard this, disagreed and went about and he killed this man.
Yes.
For having said this thing in this blasphemous situation. So now he took the law into his hands and he becomes the principle whereby the punishment is not being meted out by government or by the Sharia, by himself. The Holy Quran gives a beautiful principle that goes against this, where in Surah Al-Ahzab, chapter 33, verse number 37, it may be 36 in the Quran, which doesn't have Bismillah as the first verse, it says, "And it behooves not a believing man or a believing woman, when Allah and His Messenger have decided a matter, that they should exercise their choice in the matter concerning them." So here it's very clear. If the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has laid down certain principles and made judgments, and he's decided certain legal issues, no Muslim has the right to come behind that and to take the matter into his own hands and say, well, you know, here's a tradition that seems to go against the Holy Quran, where Salim Saab has said, the Quran has given a very clear and specific guidance on this matter. The Sunnah has given us a specific and clear guidance on this matter. But you have Muslims who are still saying, we don't emphasize this, this is what we're going to emphasize. And it creates these kind of scenarios and these problems. So we have to really pray, and we have to hope that the Muslims will come to their senses. And in a lot of these cases, you know, where they're taking justice into their own hands with no justification. We as Muslims are being, you know, portrayed in a very negative light in nations where we're trying to show them the beauty of Islam. And they say, is this the beauty of your Islam? You want me to follow your laws and leave my laws where, you know, here's a judge will tell you that in England now, they're not going to practice the laws that were during the age of Inquisition. We've gone far past this, but it seems you want us to go back to that middle period under Islamic code. Therein lies the big problem that we see hidden beneath this attack on a few innocent souls. It's the tenor, it's the tone that's being established in the Muslim world by a segment, not all, and let's be just here. You know, the majority of Muslims would probably feel as offended, as insulted as we do, you know, considering these matters. But there's a segment that has completely, you know, misinterpreted the Quran, the Hadith, the traditions to suit their own fancies, their own philosophies, and made it in fact into a religion, which is called in their eyes Islam, which Indeed. In fact it's not.
We're just in the last few minutes of the program, Dr. Zaisab. If I could just come to you, Ronald's asked various questions, and thank you, Ronald, for your different questions. But ultimately, in all that he's basing his questions on, he's quoted, for example, Bukhari, which was authentic Hadith, a book of Hadith. He's also quoted Muslim, again, which we as Ahmadi Muslims accept the six authentic, is included within the six books regarded as authentic. And then he uses those to justify that whilst he accepts the Ahmadi Muslim viewpoint, mm-hmm. that there is no stoning to death in Islam for adultery, that apostasy is not punishable by death. He quotes one or two hadiths in support that no, actually, whilst you and the Muslims may believe this, hadith actually suggests this, just as a sort of final point, I mean, encompassing the basis of his questions. How would you respond to that?
We would simply say to Ronald that whenever you find a conflict in a principle between what the Holy Quran has said and what you find in any hadith, then the Holy Quran, which is the revealed word of God, which cannot change, has not changed, cannot change, then that takes precedence over this. So be very fair about it. If you read the Holy Quran first, the guiding principles will be found in the Holy Quran, and then the Sunnah of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then obviously the hadith. If you find that there is a contradiction between a hadith and the Holy Quran, then you must consider the verdict of the Holy Quran as superior. There must be something that we have not understood, or the relators have not understood, in the relation of a particular hadith. So that is the principle always to be adopted. That is what the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, the Masih and Mahdi, who came to remove all these misconceptions from Islam that had crept in, he has said that it is the Holy Quran which is the final verdict. So in all of these questions, even if you find it in the Sahih Sitta, then you must also consider what the Holy Quran says. And if the Holy Quran is explicit about these things, as have been clearly indicated by both of these two gentlemen, then we must always take the verdict of the Holy Quran as being final.
And with the word final, that will be the final comment, certainly in terms of the answers. Gentlemen, Jazakumullah, thank you very much for your very scholarly, detailed answers to what has been quite a wide-ranging discussion, but the essence of which has been this whole issue of punishment within Islam, and indeed the draconian blasphemy laws we see in certain parts of the world. My deep thanks to you, and of course to you viewers as well. Without you, Faith Matters would not be the program it is. But just as a reminder, as a final thought, email, if you don't know, it's faithmatters@mta.tv. And those of you still wishing to use the fax, well, it's 44 for the UK, 208-687-8037. Ultimately, the message, I suppose, that which comes from this program is that if there is a word of God which you accept, which as Muslims we do, that is the final word and the word which should take precedence. Until the next time, from all of us here on Faith Matters, Assalamu alaikum.